Okay. That's good.
I can't see that.
Eventually. She's a little scared.
She is. She's hard. I can't hear me now. What'd you do?
Look at this field, Corey. You've got Matthew Dreger, Brian Thompson, Bryson James, Curtis Towns, and Steve Moore all together in the top five. Let's see how this plays out. Let's see how he comes off two this time. There's something about turn two that he gets hooked up. Comes the seven of Katie. Here comes Tanner. Big move from Joey Tanner. Tanner threaded the needle between Weinbarger and James. Drove right by him and moves to the number two spot. Oh! Contact on the backstretch. Steve Moore. Left foot up on the apron. Your new leader at a turn four. Here comes Bryson James, your leader.
Live from the Jetstream Off Massage Studio in Albany, Oregon, you're listening to Northwest Dirt News on Spreaker Radio.
Welcome back. Welcome to Northwest Dirt News here live on location.
We're live now.
From Jetstream Aqua Massage, not the studio, but we're actually on the showroom floor here. And it's kind of like the first live remote we've done. We've got an in-studio guest tonight. Tonight, join us on the show, Mr. Tom Yeack. Tom, welcome.
Yeah, hello.
It's going to be fun to have you on tonight. We're going to talk about several things. Took a little time off there because the Speed Week kind of got our schedule all jumbled up. And we're going to talk about the Wingless Series at Willamette. We're going to talk about Speed Week. We're going to talk about...
Wallbanger Cup.
Wallbanger Cup, absolutely. Yeah. That's one of the big things we're going to talk about tonight. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to talk about IMCA. We're going to talk about some rules and infractions. And
yeah, you know, we got warmed up on that already.
We've got plenty to talk about tonight. And let's start with, like we always do, thanking our sponsors. You know, we can't do this without Northwest Trucking Academy, Crocker's Cars, Archer Floor Covering, Swears Trucking. We've got Jetstream Aqua Massage, James Gang Pizza.
Stumbling J
Livestock. Yep, we've got all those guys on there, and it takes everybody to put this thing together. And boy, talking about putting things together.
Did we get everybody just then?
I don't know. Probably.
I hope so.
I hope so.
James Gang?
Yeah, we got James
Gang
there.
Okay.
So, putting things together. We sat here for about the last 2 hours putting this whole thing together and testing the system to make sure it was actually completely disassembled and moved.
Yeah.
Putting this thing back together is it's a chore.
And we had to rent a table.
We did, but a little different. So if you hear anything in the background tonight, we are not in the studio. Once again, we are on the sales floor for Jetstream Aqua Massage, and anybody can walk in here and hang out with us.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be fun. So 4th of July, your week. Guys, how'd it go?
It was great. I did a little rafting myself.
I saw that on Facebook.
Yeah, enjoyed the holidays with the family.
Yeah.
And actually, last night I traumatized my dog with a mortar. I lit one of them off. I had another half dozen. Well, the ones we picked up when we went to Vegas. And
Right. You still have those?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
And I really traumatized my dog. I felt so bad. And he was afterwards. Well, no, I didn't laugh. It scared him pretty bad. And I don't think he slept at all last night. And today he's pretty much over it, so I don't feel as bad. I still feel bad, though. Yeah. Poor guy. Scared the hell out of me.
I didn't see you at Speed Week at Willamette Speedway.
I was there one night, and I hate to cry about my back, but I was on my feet all day that day. And the next day I wanted to be there so bad, but, man, I was done from the previous, so
yeah.
I didn't make it out.
Well, we did see Tom. We always see Tom everywhere we go. He's mm-hmm. He's there. So, Tom, how have things been for you since Wallbanger Cup?
Good. You know, we've been able to just kind of kick back, take it easy a little bit. We're waiting. And I think Kyle's going to Banks this weekend to run that 1,000 to win up there.
Now he's won that a time or two, hasn't he?
I think he's only went once, and he won it once.
Well, I know he won it the night that I called it.
That was in the modified. You remember that was when he was driving Jody's modified?
Yes. That was the 30. Yeah, right.
You know, so he had a lot of fun in that car.
Does he ever lose when it comes to the big money race?
Well, have you seen our record so far this year? I mean, it's
perfect.
Cottage Grove is our best. Medford, he got a second down there after getting knocked up into the wall when he was passing for second place. The third place car drove him up on the wall, and he got a lot of respect. Pretty cool because the underside of his car was making the sparks on the wall. He was up on two wheels, sliding down the wall. He came off the wall, sideways, on the gas, and kept second place.
Wow.
It did cost him about 3 car lengths on the leader, and if he hadn't had that happen, I think he would have got that one. But
yeah.
And then Madras, our car came back in kind of a ball. You know, he went out and had a good start. Had a good starting spot. He was started 7th. Got to the front fairly quick. Was pulling away. Had a caution. Everybody caught back up. Then they took off. Brewster caught up behind him in that sportsman car. And they were running pretty strong. And he caught a lapper. He got a little loose on the outside passing the lapper. And Ron thought that was his opportunity to take the lead. And he made a pass. Tried to make a pass up through. Caught Kyle. Hit him. Then come back across the track. Hit the lapper. Knocked the lapper spinning the infield. The only problem is it cut Kyle's left rear tire when that happened. Well, we come in, change the tire. For some odd reason, they put him in front of the cars that they'd lapped, so he's in the middle of the pack. Well, they take the green, and the second-place car turns sideways, gets turned sideways, one of the two. Big stack up. Kyle plows into the back of the main pack, and then one of the lappers just came full throttle right in the back of Kyle. Kyle's car landed on top of his car.
What a mess. Kyle's sandwich, huh?
Yeah, so come back in, another wheel, another tire, change that out. Get him back out there. Now he's got like 2 to 3 inches toe out in the front. When we got the car home, found out that the rear end was bent, and it was towed in about 2 to 3 inches in the rear end. So he's got a car that's towed in the rear, towed out in the front, and he still drives back to the front. And with about 3 laps to go, the leader caught a muffler, kicked it up, and the muffler went through the nose of his car, through the radiator, into the water pump. That cost him the race.
That's a tough night of racing right there.
Yeah, you know, so we haven't had a great start to the season. I think he is leading the points in the Iron Series. So, with what we've had happen, we're still doing okay.
Well, here's one thing I can say about Kyle Yeack, watching him over the course of his career, and we've all been around racing a long time. Kyle is one of 2 drivers that I will say when there is big money on the line, you do not bet against him.
Yeah.
Kyle Yeack. The other driver, when there was big money on, he does not race anymore, was Russ Sell.
Yeah.
When there was big money up on the track and it was a big race, you did not bet against the 50. Now you don't bet against the 47. I did. I said Langen. I said it on the air. I'll eat my words. I said Langen was probably going to win that's his home track. That's a great race car. And he didn't. Kyle went down there, won the Wallbanger for the 3rd year in a row in 3 different cars.
Yeah.
Impressive.
And the week before that, down there at Cottage Grove, you guys seen he finished 4th, and you're kind of, he finished 4th. Wasn't too surprised because Langham was out there. Well, what you didn't notice was that he'd actually got to the front, was leading, but because of the Madras wreck, his steering box was bent, and it was really hard to turn, and he lost it a little bit and couldn't catch the car, and it blew the left rear tire off the bead. And he had to go back to the pits, change the tire, and he drove back up to 4th. So he was actually out front leading. He turned the fastest lap in the main event. So he had a good shot of winning that one, too, if we hadn't had remnants from Madras.
Sounds like you guys are tough on left rears. Man, that's a lot of left rears you just talked about.
G60s suck.
Well, I think that's the general consensus from a lot of people, the feedback that we're getting.
We've ran 4 races on G60s. I've spent more money on G60s than I did all last year for my sportsman car and the street stock car. And
not surprised.
Yeah, I mean, and I've got to go buy 2 more tires to go to Banks, because we wiped out a tire in 40 laps. Our first night at Grove, we lost a tire. And don't tell me to shut
up. No, I wasn't talking to you.
that was
good. He's looking at me like, are you telling me to quit talking?
And he looks around.
And we wiped out a G60 down in Cottage Grove that opening night in hot laps, trophy dash, and a heat race, and we lost a brand new tire. Wore it out. It was peeling off. It's these 3,300-pound cars on these G60s, and you get any kind of rubber or dryness, and, man, they just fry.
Yeah. And that we're hearing that from a lot of different drivers. So that seems to be, I think with that G60 tire, it's either the drivers really like them or are absolutely just totally against them. it seems to be it's one way or the other. You don't hear a guy go, oh, you know, well, it doesn't make much difference.
I think I've heard more negative than I have positive,
right,
by far.
And that's our feedback here at Moxie.
I can't even think of who I heard talk positive. I don't recall anybody.
When you're racing for $100 to win at most of these places, it's $125.
And you're spending $150 on a tire?
$118 for a tire. You know, you got to buy one a week at least to keep up on them. And that's not counting if somebody runs into you and cuts a tire. There goes another tire, another $118, you know. So you can easily go, you know, we could afford to go in the hole, you know, $25-$50 a night. As it stacks up, you know, it's hard to afford to go to in the hole every week another $118 on top of that $50 you're going in the hole.
Right.
You know, I mean, none of us expect to make any money at this, but
right,
it gets to a point where, you know, it's like I've got to make up my mind whether or not we're going to just go deep in the hole. You know, I work for a living, so to go an extra $400-$600 a month in the hole just because of tires, guess what? You know, it's like, well, my car's parked this year. Even though I can run slicks, I still have to go out and buy 8 to 12 new tires just to come out for the year. So
sounds like,
you know,
a guy needs to buy stock in G60s.
No kidding, Hoosier. No kidding. Were you with the Wingless race, Tom?
No,
you guys were out of town racing.
Yeah, we were taking the night off. One of the two.
I thought that was a race. You know, I think they brought 12 cars. 12 cars. Not a bad show overall. Some surprises, Warren. You and I were calling that show, and the battle for the lead in the feature was definitely the race of the night.
Yeah,
with Lance Hallmark, Rob Lindsay, and Kyle Miller.
Right.
These guys went nose to tail and three wide. I mean, they
put on a good show.
They did. It was for only really having 12 cars on a big track like that. It was surprising how when Miller made his way up towards the front, the battle he had with Lindsay and Lance Hallmark, I mean, he did everything he could to get by those guys and just couldn't do it.
Yeah.
Now, this is where, again, I thought the track conditions created, number one, good racing, and it created
havoc.
Well, at the same time, right.
Yeah.
The track was better that night. That's where the track really started getting good before, you know, the weekend of the modified series, the Wild West Modified Shootout.
Hopefully that was the last, if you will, bad week of the track we're going to see.
Right, and I wanted to bring that up because we saw, you know, I think getting those sprint cars out there, number one, with some heat, and then putting those big tires out there, I think it did help smooth the track over a little bit. And then,
did you see on the front stretch where little pockets of the track were gone? I mean, it was like a pothole on the highway.
But they were about 12 feet long and about 10 inches wide.
Yeah.
It was the strangest thing.
There were sinkholes.
Well, we saw, you know, the thing at Willamette's been the corners.
Yeah,
it's been the corners where they've been really rough, and guys are struggling, and springs popping out of modifieds. The night of the Wingless series, it was completely opposite. The corners were actually pretty good, pretty racy. Now the straightaways, we saw the straightaways chunk up a little bit, and I don't know if it was
peel up,
the big right rears tearing the track. I don't know what it was, but it was actually quite strange.
It was.
The track did slick over. It did take a little bit of rubber towards the end. It gets smoothed out. We saw pretty good racing in all classes that night, top to bottom. The Wingless sprint was probably the best Wingless sprint race I've seen at Willamette ever.
I thought it was a good race.
A three-car battle for the lead. Lance Hallmark ultimately crossed the line first, and he held off the defending champion of that race, Rob Lindsay.
Yeah.
Rob, we saw last year, did a phenomenal job. He got to the front. There was nobody going to touch him. Just silk smooth. Well, he did that this year, too. Once he caught Lance Hallmark, he was silk smooth, got next to him, but he couldn't get by
him. Get around.
And he tried him on the inside, tried him on the outside, a little bump and run, and Hallmark was just absolutely...
He was on his game.
He was. That was one of the best driven sprint car races, wing or not, I've ever seen at Willamette.
And that's saying a lot coming from you.
Well, I've been there a long time.
Well, you really don't care for the sprint cars.
Well, I'll watch them. But at Willamette, I mean, here's why I don't like sprint cars at Willamette. I mean, I'll watch them at Grove. Sprint cars at Willamette, it's typically a single file, follow the leader.
Typically.
This race was everything I said that Willamette usually is. It wasn't.
I mean, it was
a three-car battle. It was, if it would have been late models.
There was more than one groove.
Yeah. It was three lines, and these guys were working it. And unfortunately, Kyle Miller got the car turned around and went to the back and put on a pretty good show coming back up to third.
Yeah.
Rob Lindsay and Lance Hallmark, though, what a race.
Yeah.
Two quality drivers. I mean, they gave everybody, each other, just, there was...
as McKenzie would say, they were rolling.
They were. But the respect, I mean, two drivers that were pretty aggressive attacking that.